giving glory to God, the Father, His Son Jesus, the Holy Spirit, who's the great head of my life, to Pastor Brown, First Lady Brown, officers and members of this church, the pastors, officers, and members of visiting churches. It gives me just great pleasure, I don't take it lightly, to stand in this pulpit before you as a living testament of what our God can do. Yes, what our God can do. As a 6-year breast cancer survivor and as a 2-time cancer survivor, look at God. But we need to take every second, every minute, every hour, every day, every week, every month as an awareness. Let's take a little journey. Your doctors told you that you have breast cancer. You may be shocked. You may be feeling angry, sad, scared, depressed, confused, in disbelief, and maybe even questioning the accuracy of the diagnosis. How can I have breast cancer when I don't feel or act sick? How can I have breast cancer when no one in my family have ever had this disease? How can I have breast cancer when I'm living a healthy life? How can I have breast cancer when I'm a child of God? These are just some of the questions we may ask in an effort to understand why this has happened. Well, I'm here to tell you, as a child of God, as a living being, expect it. Expect the storms of life. Expect the storms of life to keep raging in our life. And as the songwriter would say, sometimes things would happen and in our life and we won't be able to tell night from day. But we must hold on. Hold on, because Isaiah 53:5 reminds us that he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. We all know someone who has been affected by breast cancer. It could be a friend, mother, father, sister, brother, or maybe even you. I'm here to tell you that breast cancer does not discriminate. But as we look at the research, breast cancer has had a devastating effect on African American and Hispanic women. Partly because we often don't follow up once we have been diagnosed. We often don't get screened. Fear sets in, concerns about costs, and most of all, lack of knowledge. And people, one of the things we perish for a lack of knowledge. There is a stigma, a shame attached to the disease, and as a result, people don't speak about their secret burden. This is a cycle that we need to break. But the good news, early detection, early screening, mammograms, yearly preventative care can help to improve the chance of survival. Statistics shows that 90% who finds out early are cancer-free at the 5-year milestone. I'm one of those statistics. 60% of breast cancer cases are diagnosed before they spread. And as we see, we have metastatic, which is also on the rise. And that's where the breast cancer has spread, because it has gone beyond. Treatment, there's treatment. Treatment may include surgery, chemotherapy, hormone therapy, biological therapy, and or radiation. But as a breast cancer survivor, I'm here today because I took the time to get screened. I reached my 5th-year milestone last October, but it all began at the age of 44, July of 2015. where the disturbing news, it just made me pause in my tracks. After going in for my routine mammogram, I was diagnosed with invasive carcinoma, which is breast cancer. It really just caught me off guard. After, at that time, 13 years of surviving Hodgkin's lymphoma, I was in my late third stage, early fourth stage. And with this experience, I can relate to the woman with the issue of blood. Because at that time, I searched all over, from Donaldsonville, Baton Rouge, to New Orleans, and I couldn't find nobody, not an answer. It took me a whole year before I was diagnosed. I wanted to give up. Many times, I just wanted to commit suicide. I was suffering in pain, and the doctors didn't know what was going on. But you know, church, it wasn't until I wouldn't say rebellious, but I grew up in a Christian family. But as the baby of the family, you know, we tend to get away with a lot. I was out in the world at that time, you know, but God sometimes will do things to get your attention, and he got my attention. With that experience, I give my life to Christ. And it wasn't until I give my life to Christ that things started moving. Answers started coming to the forefront. And you know, Satan, he's always there. He's always there. I got a diagnosis of Hodgkin's lymphoma. I started treatment immediately because there's four stages, and I was in that fourth stage. Doctors told me, Ms. Jones, you will never be able to have any children. You can always adopt. Okay, doctor, I hear you. But after being married for 2 years, I always said after my second year, I'll start my family. Well, it was the second year. Guess what? Started the chemotherapy, and later on, I found out I'm expecting. Doctor said, you have to terminate this pregnancy. Okay, doctor, we're going to terminate the pregnancy. Set up an appointment and all. But after a year, you know, just going back and forth to the doctor, thinking I'm having the mental issues, just didn't know what was going on. They're not being able to tell me what's going on. I accepted my ailment at that point. But when the doctor told me I had to terminate that pregnancy, I went home after that. And one day I was home, and a still voice came to me and said, who are you to give consent to take a life? I pounded on that for a while, and I remember going to seek the elders. I had a lot of people praying for me. I spoke with one of my elder ushers, and I told him, Miss Maybell, I said, I had a still voice to come to me. She said, baby, that's God. Don't you go through with that. And, you know, I went back to the doctor, and I told her I couldn't go through with it. That was a battle. Another battle, Satan always in another battle, because she refused to sign off on the chemotherapy. What detrimental effect you having on your body? It was a life and death. Your baby may be here deformed. If you make it, the doctors were scratching their head. 20 weeks, I'm still pregnant. So the doctor, I just prayed to God, and I said, I wanted this baby. I wanted the treatment too. I wanted to survive. And I prayed to God, and I said, Lord, if this is for me, but I say this too generic. You know, it's just, I went and I was more specific. I said, Lord, if it's for me to have this baby and continue to live, allow my doctor to come around and treat me. And guess what? I got that phone call. And she said, come on in, we're gonna talk. I've done some research, look at God. We continue to do the treatment. Pregnant, taking ABVD, chemotherapy. Something that, you know, doctors was just puzzled as to why I had miscarried. But I'm here to tell you, doctor told me I wasn't going to be able to have any kids. And as of today, I have three kids, three beautiful daughters. I put it in his hand, and guess what? He worked it all out. He worked it all out. You just have to trust and believe. So now to be told that I now have another type of cancer, breast cancer. You know, at that point, I had to pivot from my fresh fleshly feelings and fall on my knees and put my faith in action. I never wavered in my faith because I knew that God did it before and he'll do it again. I went on about my busy day. I felt stronger this go around. Did I have some moments? Of course. Yes, I had my moments. But I really thought I was going to be an emotional wreck. But God has a way of just giving you that peace. That peace that surpasses all understanding of the whole situation. I felt the Spirit telling me just to be still. Be still. I was able to pull from my previous experience that God granted for such a time. And when he do it, he'll prepare you. He'll prepare you all the time. Flashback, maybe about a year before that, I was at home cleaning and I remember it so vividly. Had the broom in my hand, and that was a segment that came across where a doctor was coming to Baton Rouge from New Orleans, and he was using the flaps, your tissue, to rebuild your for breast cancer patients. And he went into the emergency, the room, the surgery room and all, and I thought that was so interesting. I actually sat down in front and I looked at it and I said, oh, wow, this is just interesting. You don't have to use the foreign object to reconstruct. You use your own tissue. I was like, wow. But when I was diagnosed, I got in touch with my previous oncologist, and she told me, come on down to get a second opinion. I went, that's the way they had to do it, for the insurance purposes. And the oncologist the breast oncologist, he was like, you know, you're young. I want you to have reconstruction surgery. He gave me this card. He said, I want you to go and check this doctor out. So I went on to the doctor. Doctor showed me his portfolio, telling me, you know, the process and all. And he wanted to hear from me. So I brought that back to my remembrance where I seen the segment. And I wanted to tell him. And I started telling him about the segment. And at that point, I'm seeing him messing with his phone, but I just wanted to get out that I thought it was awesome that you can use your own flap, your own tissue to rebuild. And I think that's the way I wanted to go. But at this time, the doctor, he's showing me the video. I'm looking at the video, but I'm still talking, just wanted to get it out. When I really zoomed in into the video, realize this is the doctor. That was the doctor that actually was given the segment on the news years prior to me being diagnosed. And I just say, you know what? God is in control. This is confirmation on top of confirmation on top of confirmation. So on September 23rd, 2015, after enduring 7 hours of having a bilateral mastectomy, I'm here to say that all is well. I can't stop praising him because I know his grace and mercies is new every day. And I know I couldn't have done this without seeking God for guidance, seeking God at all time. I had so many confirmations when making my decision. I just turn it over to him and he worked it out. Last year, I finished my hormonal therapy. I was told that I was going to have to do hormonal therapy for 7 to 10 years, but I was able to do it for 5 years. I was part of a research where I didn't know that they saved my breast tissue and they sent it off to California, where I was able to get an index score. I was able to stop my hormonal therapy at 5 years. So before I take my seat, you guys, I know Pastor Brown has been doing an awesome job these last couple of Sundays. He's always doing an awesome job teaching and preaching God's word. But he was speaking on Job, and I can relate to Job too as well. We all know the story of Job. Job is described as a good man who loves God. Satan challenged God saying that Job is only good because he had a happy life. God allows Satan to put Job's faith to test by causing him to suffer. I think I have some witnesses. Job showed us how to keep the faith no matter how grim the circumstances of life may be. I think a lot of you all can witness that. You see, church, I'm here to tell you that innocent suffering do exist. Yes, there's such thing as innocent suffering. 1 Peter 4 and 12 reminds us, beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon to test you as though something strange were happening to you, but rejoice insofar as you share Christ's suffering, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. A lot of I just have a different outlook on life now because I know a lot of things that I go through is nothing, can't be compared to what God went through for us. So let's remember some key nuggets from Job. Job 13 and 15, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. How many Jobs we have in the house? You know, sometimes the stakes are innumerous. God will allow things to happen just to see where your faith lies. Job 13:36-1, God provides. Only him. I didn't look nowhere else. When I looked and I gave it to him, oh my God. How many Jobs we have in this house? How many people can associate with Job? Job 34:32, Lord, teach me what I cannot see. Won't he do it? Job 5:9, he performs wonders that cannot be fathomed. Miracles that cannot be counted. How many Jobs we have in the house? Job 23:10, he knows the way that I take when he has tested me. I will come forth as pure gold. He will do it, I tell you. He will do it. Job 1:21, the Lord gives and the Lord take away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Do know, and I've come to the realization, we are here for a point of time, just passing through. Don't know when, don't know where, don't know how. So far, before I take my seat, I behoove us to meditate on the word of God. Because Proverbs tells us that it is medicine and strength to our bones. So I ask you, who report are you going to believe? Believe the report of the Lord. And we trust him to be the great physician. We trust only God, the great one. Lord, we will continue to trust you to be the great I am that I am. Thank you.